really hard out of the Police Council is making sure that there is information on our website, on Facebook page. We have a monthly newsletter that goes out. We have something like 1,500 people that receive our newsletter. So a monthly update of what's going on. I'm pleased to get an email from Helga about the IDDD support group that she's involved with. There is a website, but I don't know what that is.
Oh, no,
that's me,
but it's my
lesson.
Look up your website.
There is a website, they've got some fantastic publicity materials. Probably everybody's aware of Dodgers List, which is an American site with huge amount of resources available on disease. And we have some fact sheets. If you go on the Breed Council's website, daxihealth.org.uk, there's a video of a veterinary surgeon who presented at our 2009 conference. I think it's about 30 minutes of him talking about fact sheets. So there's a really good stuff. And the one slide that your veterinary surgeon needs to know is diagnosis and prognosis. Again, probably you are all aware of that, but it seems that an awful lot of owners and even their vets aren't aware of the pain response level and the intervention strategy that the vet needs to take depending on the pain response level if your dog has a pain. So, for me, that's an absolutely a key slide. A for owners, but B also for vets. Right, let's move on and talk about the flora disease. Who's got mini wires? Who has seen a case of the flora disease? Who has seen a case of the flora disease?
No one in Australia.
No one in Australia.
We have a problem.
Two only guy eyes very common and rich.
If I asked the question of a show group in the UK, I probably wouldn't get a very good response. The number of people who have never ever seen a case of the four instances. If you ask the vet, not only have they not seen it, they've never even heard of it. And one of our pet advisors did a survey of owners who have the four affected dogs. And I think it was 95% of those owners' vets didn't know what the condition was when it was presented to them. Mm. So it may well be out there, but it's not been diagnosed. And the vet researchers don't necessarily recognize it. We are now at the point, having had a screening program in place for getting it for a couple of years, 85% of the litters that are being bred are what you might describe as safe, so they will not have infected puppies in them. Overall, the prevalence in the mini wire population at the start of the screening program was about 10%. So 1 in 10 mini wires affected by the flora disease. One of the other issues associated with it is that it's late onset, and therefore some dogs get it very, very late onset, and it might be a real struggle for people to actually identify the dog with flora disease. It's an inherited late onset, what's known as progressive myoclonic epilepsy. So it is a form of epilepsy, but it's distinguished by jerking fits. And dogs that, for example, see bright flashing lights can react to that. They also jerk in response to loud noises. If you go on to Dr. Claire Rusbridge's website, there are some video clips that she has on there. She's probably the UK's specialist expert on the flora disease. She has some video clips that you can see. It is a really, really distressing condition. One of our pet advisors has set up a flora support group, leforadogs.com, I think it is. Again, there are video clips on there. She's put some videos on YouTube of her dog, and you can see the distressing state of the flora disease. Complex partial seizures. It's a really unpleasant condition for the dogs that progress to it. They can go blind, they have dementia, it's panic attacks, they can't progress. It is caused by a mutation, and interestingly, it's a disease that humans get as well. If a person is diagnosed with the form, it's pretty unlikely that they're going to survive to beyond their teens. The test was developed by the Hospital for Sick Kids in Toronto, Canada, and they found the mutation by using miniature wirehead Dachshunds back in 2004-2005, and there are two mutations, this EPM2B and EPM2A, and the test that was developed through the wires is now available for humans, so that we can actually help people who potentially have that mutation as well. But if you've got the disease, it's something about the proteins in the brain, and they accumulate too many carbohydrates. There is therefore some interesting possibility around dietary management of it, but it's very early days in terms of, is there something that's going to make a difference? It is recessive, therefore, if the sire and the dam carry the mutation, then you are significantly at risk of the disease. We've done quite a lot of research and quite a lot of data collection around it. It's probably a statement that would mind be the obvious, but the more inbred the dog, the more likely it is to suffer from the disease. So we did some work looking at the coefficient of inbreeding and the proportion of dogs at different levels of inbreeding, whether they had or didn't have rapport. And really the graph that we need to look at is a bit statistical, I suspect, but broadly it says the higher the coefficient of inbreeding value, the higher its risk of being a form of effect. Probably what we expect. Having said that, look at the graph on the left, the red bars are affected dogs, the green bars are not affected dogs. And clearly we have some not affected dogs with high coefficients to breeding, just the way population statistics works. But if you breed them too closely together, you are inevitably going to increase the risk of two of these mutations popping out together. What shocks me actually from the graph on the left is that there are dogs out there with coefficients of inbreeding of 20%, 30%, 40%. Is that an index that you're using or familiar with the coefficient of inbreeding over here? So the Kennel Club will no longer register brother and sister for those sorts of populations which give you 12.5% coefficient. So we identified the mutation in 2005. It took until 2010 for the Wire Club to decide they were going to initiate a screening program. That's not a criticism of the Wire Club. A lot of people had never ever seen the condition, so it's this sort of, is it a problem, isn't it a problem? Our Breed Club's raised £25,000 to support the program, and we had £17,000 of funding from the Kennel Club Charity Trust as well. And that's enabled us to put together a full DNA test, which will identify clear carrier affected dogs. That's been available since 2013. Done with blood tests. You have to send the bloods off to Canada to have them analysed. It typically takes a couple of months to get the results back. So it's not the sort of test that I've got my litter of puppies sat here, can I do a test and know what the results are before I sell the puppies. We absolutely have to be before testing the parents of any dogs that we're trying to be collecting. Current UK cost is £225. We subsidise that, so we make a contribution so that owners only have to pay £150. And it is now formally recognised by the Kennel Club, so all the data from when you go into the database on the company and look at the health test results, you can see all with every dog's before the test results. One of the conditions that we made on giving people the subsidy was that they would allow us to share the results of the test. It was absolutely essential from a health committee perspective that the data was on was in the public domain.
So if you
look it up on the Kennel Club's website and you can see whether it's been tested and you can see whether it's tested. And on the Wire Club's website, there's an Excel spreadsheet that's got every single dog that's been tested back to 2010. So there are hundreds of dogs in there, and it's color-coded, red, amber, and green. So red for affected dogs, amber for carrier, and green for clear dogs in there. So it is really, really visible, and it's not a difficult task to go and look at what a symptomatic dog looks like. It's absolutely essential that this data is out in the public domain. If we hide it, we can't make informed decisions, and we are inflicting affected puppies on the bias of our puppies.
We started before this testing, and mainly they are our affected testing puppies as well.
Right.
Now, the first batch of samples have been sent to Toronto, and we're still waiting on the results of those. Now, again, we are asking why we went. To get enough samples for them to give us a discount or to make it affordable has been extremely difficult. Getting them all connected and sent at one time has been impossible. Dr. Manassian has been very, very generous with allowing samples to be taken at different times to be part of the cohort of different testing. It's going to cost us roughly
$200 each dog.
No, I think
$200. $200.
No, us.
Something
more than
including the subsidy.
Yes,
$280. And we're getting free, we have free from Sydney for a pet people called Accident in the Park. They are giving us a subsidy which pays for the crate of those samples. So at the moment, we have got two samples that we are waiting. And we should get those results very soon. And we need to encourage more people around Australia to get together and to do it. But we have a very small population.
We've got a small population of many wires. I think I have no idea what you have in terms of pedigrees behind the many wire population. If you have UK bred dogs, I would encourage you to look on the Wirehead Dachshund Club website, and you will see the status of all the dogs in there. If you have dogs that come from affected lines, I think it would be really, really wise to do the test. I know it's probably expensive, I know it's logistically difficult, but do you want 1 in 10 of your puppies?
And especially with the dogs,
it really is something. I can't imagine how logistically difficult it must be for you guys. You
know, well, we've got 17 samples
up in Sydney. Well, we use a veterinary practice in the centre of England, and we have a testing session or a screening session probably every 4 or 5 months. People go along to that. If they can't get there, so you know, people from Scotland, it would be a 300-mile drive. So they would get their local veterinary surgeon to take the blood sample and send it down. It's, you know, it's absolutely critical that it sort of hits the veterinary surgery on the same day, but it's all going to be packaged and sent off. So you have a scaled up complexity compared with us.
I just wanted to ask, in the US they do integrate, so you have a dachshund, it's like smooths and longs may have if they're bred to wild, mini wires. The other main question I have in this, why people don't address it, is what's to say other dachshunds without integrating do have the flaws? What's the trigger that you say it's just in mini wires?
Okay.
Our logistic that it forms.
It's a really interesting question. How do we know that it's not in any of the other varieties? There have been a small number of cases in miniature smooths, which is probably not a surprise. there's a real challenge around, if it's not easy to diagnose, how do you know that it's not there? Having said that, you would think there would be some noise around.
Shouldn't we test the others? Because it seems less, it's a very good
question. You could make that decision to test the others. We've chosen not to. We don't have... It's chicken and egg, isn't it? We don't have the evidence, but if you don't collect the evidence, you won't have the evidence. But there's nothing anecdotal to say that it's a problem. Whereas actually, if you look at the miniature longs, there is evidence that they have idiopathic epilepsy, but unfortunately there's no test. So actually I'd be much more worried about epilepsy in mini longs than Lephora in any of the other varieties. We had an issue with epilepsy in the standard wires going back to the mid-80s, but that was idiopathic. There's no evidence of this type of fitting.
But if you like the general population tested, you never know.
And if you are cross variety breeding, then there is certainly.
That's more. Okay, Thompson.
Just
say that
you
could smoke
that would affect it more.
I'm saying.
I don't have any data on the amount of dogs. There's even less testing going on in the States. The British population is by far away, miles ahead. There are a small number of people on the continent that are now testing Scandinavia, for example, but it's a very low proportion. You need to look at the database on the Wirehead Dachshund Club website for the pedigree information. And if you have dogs that are affected from that list of dogs, then that's where you need to be really concerned about doing the testing.
We
take
that line American
line. I don't have any data. It's exactly that same point. Like, if you don't test, you don't know.
With the other breeds that apparently have it, as in the Bassets and the Beagles, are any of those breed clubs doing the testing? And what are the results like compared to the mini wire results?
Again, the Beagles and the Bassets people are saying, oh, we've never seen it, but we have had a small number of samples from people who had dogs referred to Claire Rusbridge with Lephora symptoms. We've sent blood samples, and yes, they've got Lephora. So it is in there, but again, they're not at the stage as a breed community of, say, recognising, being interested enough to do something about it. And this is always the challenge, isn't it, about, are we going to be open about this stuff, or are we just going to...
Have you had any of the mini wire breeders over there say, no, I don't want to go on any website, or I don't need to have my results published, or...?
We have had breeders... In the early days of the test, who didn't think it was a problem, didn't want to participate in the screening program, there was nobody said we won't have our test results published because they never got to that stage. They didn't want to have the test, so there was no issue about should you publish those or not. We had stuff around we don't believe the results, the test isn't reliable. Yeah, any possible excuse that you can imagine in the early days of the test, we had those. The Wire Club has been absolutely rigorous and consistent about saying this is a test that is, bird monacin in Canada would not be doing a test for humans that wasn't viable and reliable. So they've been really consistent. It is a reliable, valid test. We now have the Kennel Club saying we recognise it as a test. There is no debate. Use the test, find the results. But there will still be people who are in denial and not prepared to participate in it. I have to say, in the show community, I think we're well past that particular stage. There are certainly people who are breeding pets who have never heard of it. I've never seen it, so why would I want that? Two aspects of the former screening. One is education. In the early days, we knew it was a recessive mutation, so a lot of communication material around what the hell does that mean that it's a recessive mutation. So our sort of colour chart, luckily I didn't see any green, red around the Dachshunds yesterday. Green ones are the clear ones, so if you put two green ones together, you're never going to get a red one, which is effective. did, if you put a clear and a carrier together, what are you going to get? We need to try and make it as simple as possible, but you'll still get people looking at that and saying, what the hell does it mean? So it's a continual communication challenge and battle to help people understand even simple recessive mutations. The chart on the right, we have a Kennel Club breed record supplement where every single litter is recorded and published on a quarterly basis, and the chart shows the Lophora status of all the litters that have been bred since winter 2012. And the green is the proportion of those litters where there will not be an affected puppy, and the red is the proportion of those litters that will still be at risk of having an affected puppy. And that, to me, is a really fabulous trend that shows that people are doing the testing increasingly, and we're moving to the stage where a significantly small proportion of dogs are at risk of having a
fairly quick flare there in a short time.
In a relatively short time.
Yeah.
So 2012 to summer 15. And I think the only reason that's happened is the continuous flow of communication and absolute consistent messaging about this is important. There are 10% of the dogs historically out there that are affected. If there are 10% of dogs that are affected, there are probably 45 to 50% carriers in the population. And if you know there's that proportion of carriers in the population, there is a huge risk of producing more affected dogs. So that's a great graph, a real credit thing to the people that have taken that testing.
Can I have a good feel about the group? Anyone here who wants to can subscribe to the
DachshundBreedCouncil.org.uk. Subscribe.
Already
did subscribe, not on the newsletter. You just missed my October one, but you can go
no,
on.
No, got it yesterday.
It came out. The power of technology, I can be in Australia and still send out. although my motel is slightly challenged. I'm going to go on to PRA. I'm conscious that we are probably running out of time. So, the Lophora strategy, communication. Message for buyers is, do not buy a puppy if people are not participating in the screening program and cannot tell you that one of the dogs in the mating is clear. And we are getting to the point where people are finding it difficult to sell puppies because the pressure from the buyers is, we wouldn't touch it with a barge pole. And that is our objective, make it impossible for people who are not using the test to sell their puppies. You do need to see the paper.
But the
other aspect of that is, please look on the Wire Club's website and you can see the dog. Please go on the Kennel Club website and you can see the dog's name. If you can't see the dog's name and the test result, walk away. Encouraging breeders to avoid the at-risk matings, and again, you know, as you mentioned, the newsletter every month. I think for the last 3 years there's been something on the Lophora disease in every single newsletter. Vets, we have sent information sheets to every single veterinary school in the UK. Generally those practices are aware of it, not necessarily very widely. We are encouraging our breed club members to take the information sheets into their veterinary practices as well. We've had letters published in the veterinary journals, for example, so the chairman of our health subcommittee has published letters in the...
How do we get it to the Australian vets?
You presumably have a veterinary college. You probably have university veterinary schools. We've got a paper on our website, which is an information sheet for vets. Send them that, send them any of our stuff. If you want something specific, let me know, I'll write it for you. You've probably got veterinary journals. Just tell them. And the Wire Club wrote to non-UK breed clubs, I don't know whether you had letters in any of your Australian clubs telling them about the test and encouraging them to make use of that test as well. Education, seminars, conferences, screening, open registry, formal recognition and badges. One of the many wire breeders, at her own expense, produced these and gave them out to people in France. There's some really committed people. Called Ron PRA, sorry to make you wait right to the bitter end around Called Ron PRA. Okay, I'm not sure whether my exchange rate is right, but in the UK, I had a look on our database, there's about 7,000 miniature Dachshunds of all three coats that have now been DNA tested for Called Ron PRA since 2005. So getting over £250,000 been spent on Called Ron testing, which is a phenomenal amount of money. It is interesting about prevalence and whether there are dogs going on. So it was first documented in the mini longs probably around 2000 that they started to have some concerns about miniature longs going blind. The Animal Rights Trust came up with a DNA test. It is a simple recessive mutation which they labelled called one colon belt dystrophy. It has been found in the miniature smooth population and the miniature wire population, probably not surprisingly, but the mutation frequency is significantly lower in the mini wire population. And actually there's probably an argument for is it really necessary in the mini wire given a very low mutation frequency. I'll show you some of the actual data. So it's a recommendation that people with all the miniature varieties do test it. We have a breeder scheme run by the Kennel Club called the Assured Breeder Scheme. It's a requirement that you're a member of that scheme whether you use that DNA test. I think pretty universally people in the breed club community in the UK will be using that for one test. About £45 I think. $60 something like that. So it's not hugely expensive, it's in a different league to the flora screening costs.
We can have them tested
in Australia. Yeah. And it's a simple cheap swab, so it's just so much easier for people. The thing that makes it really interesting, from a should we test or should we test perspective, is that we now know that there's a second mutation which is what affects the age of onset. And there's a paper that was recently by the Wire Lab in the States, where they're honing in on that mutation. There isn't a DNA test for it. If you have two copies of the Called Ron mutation and two copies of the second mutation, it will be early onset. Mm-hmm. And that is almost certain what's going on in the early days of the miniature longs, where there were early onset blindness. If you have two copies of the Called Ron mutation and don't have two copies of the second mutation, the dog is more likely to have late onset. And it might be so late onset that actually it's dead. Or it's blind because it's old. So there's a degree of complexity. It is not as simple as perhaps we thought back in 2005. Now, personally, that's not, in my view, that's not an excuse to stop testing. These charts show the percentage of each of the three genotypes, affected, carrier, and clear, going back to 2005 when the testing started. So when we started testing mini longs, so this is the miniature long one, something like 18% of the dogs were affected. Through to the end of last year, which is my last final annual set of data, we were down to 4%, 5% or something. What I find really interesting looking at those graphs is what happens to the carrier percentage. It's not really changed an awful lot. And therein lies an interesting clue around, oh, let's rely on DNA testing to sort out all our health problems. It's extremely difficult to reduce the population of carriers just by selecting doses of DNA tests and using clear dogs. So, yes, we have increased the proportion of clear dogs in the population, but there's still a lot of carriers out there. So that's why, for me, it makes it still important to carry on doing the testing and only if you've got a carrier dog, getting it clear. So that's where we started from with the miniature longs. The miniature smooths, so this is a different axis on the timeline at the bottom. The mini smooth testing started around about 2007, and interestingly quite a high proportion of affected dogs in there. There was a lot of challenge around in the miniature smooth community about we aren't seeing very many dogs going blind, so why do we need to be using this test? And I suspect it's very much related to that second mutation that exists. If you've got two copies of both mutations, they will be going blind at an early age. If you've only got one copy of the second mutation, you may have to actually detect it as well. So that's what has happened, and again, there's been really good uptake of the testing from the mini smooth people. The mutation frequency is probably down to something like, not mutation frequency, but percentage of each genotype is down to about 8% or something by the end of last year. And again, really tough to make a change to the proportion of carriers that are out there. You know, all this, we'll do DNA testing and it'll make everything all right. It really is not as straightforward as that. Then the mini wires to find the graph. And if you looked at that data, you'd probably say we probably really don't actually need to be testing the mini wires for PLA. There's another form of PRA that exists in the DAX, I don't know whether something you come across it. It was discovered in the standard wires in Norway, which is day blindness. Cord one is a night blindness. There is a DNA test for day blindness. We did a screening in the UK of wires and miniature wires probably about 4 years ago. It was a very, very low mutation frequency in there, so we're not actually recommending that people use that test. I'm certainly not asking for it to be a requirement. Our recommendation is if you have dogs that are imported from Scandinavia, you absolutely should be doing that test. Okay? Because if you aren't, you are at risk of importing that mutation, and we all know what happens if that goes on the chat. So if any of you have Scandinavian breeding in standard wires, I would definitely recommend you doing that. That same mutation is also in the miniature wires. So if you have Scandinavian bred miniature wires, it would be worth doing that testing. You'd probably be lucky. It's a low mutation frequency as far as we're aware. It's worth doing that. So the current status on cord 1 PRA, they won't necessarily develop retinal degeneration. And you know, some people will say, oh well, we can stop testing. Choose that conclusion if you wish. Affected dogs usually have some photoreceptor loss and degeneration. The degree of loss depends on age, and it also, when they do the sort of the histopathology, the changes in the cell tissues, it is obvious. They've done electro-retina, there's EMG, I can't remember what the G stands for, the graph was on. Dogs that are showing no loss of sight that are caught unaffected show up on that electrical testing as having some degeneration. So just because my dog can see, apparently see all right, doesn't necessarily mean that it doesn't have retinal degeneration. We know about the second mutation, which I've talked about, and that affects the age of onset in the condition. There was a bit of a warbler thrown out by Labaclin. I don't know whether you've come across them. They're one of the DNA testing labs in the UK. They said they're no longer going to offer cord blood testing. It's no longer a requirement for miniature Dachshund people to use this test. That's because of the paper that was published by the Aguirre lab, which basically refers to that second mutation. So we've consulted with the Kennel Club and the Animal Health Trust, and they're pretty definitive about it is something that you should continue to use. So, it is coming up to 6 minutes to 12, which is miraculously close to 2 hours, which you've just about managed to sit through. I'm going to see anyone dozing off that, hopefully. I've no idea whether that's what you wanted, what you expected, whether you've got any questions or any feedback for me. I'm happy to say go and enjoy the sunshine, or I'm happy to talk with people, or I'm bored, perhaps I feel better.